Hi world, I'm Gordy. Mind control is not only possible, it's happening all the time, all around us. Invisible to the untrained eye, but it's definitely here. But governments don't care about nature, so how does nature get its mind controlled? Thankfully, there are a few tiny organisms that have evolved to influence the decisions of other animals and get what they need to survive. Cordyceps unilateris is an insect pathogenic fungi that is predominantly found in the rainforest and the skulls of dead ants. Thousands of these cute little fungi's spores spread themselves across the rainforest. If an ant happens to breathe in a single Cordyceps spore, it will become infected and is in for a real, real bad time. Once it has infected the ant, the fun little fungi use bioactive compounds to interfere with the ant's nervous system and literally take complete control of its muscles. Not its brain, its muscles. Like a real-life fever dream, the fungi will guide the ant to a spot with the ideal humidity and temperature for fungal growth. Somehow, the fungi will find the perfect spot and hunker down by forcing the ant into a death grip. A death grip is when the fungi forces an ant to chomp down on a leaf and lock itself into position. This is to make sure the ant doesn't move while it slowly starves to death for the next 4 to 10 days. Once dead, the fungi will begin consuming its body, and 3 weeks later, it will have grown a crown on top of the ant's head. When ready, it explodes thousands of cute little fungi all over the jungle, repeating the cycle. Euploricus californensis is a parasite that lives in the salty marshes of Southern California and affects 3 different organisms during its life cycle. A snail, a fish, and a birdie bird! The start of the life cycle occurs when an infected bird poops out the parasite's eggs, and an unlucky mud snail decides to eat that poop. After making its home inside the snail, the parasite will grow into its second stage, genitalia disrespectlia, and it will immediately castrate the snail.
Hi-ya.
The UO will hang out here for a little while and use the snail's energy reserves to make multiple copies of itself. Once the snail is all used up, the parasite will leave and search for its next victim, the killifish. If it's able to attach itself to a killifish, stuff gets intense. Inside the fish, the parasite will crawl along its nerve and form a carpet-like layer over the fish's brain. Here, the parasite will be able to elicit responses in the fish that make it literally 30 times more likely to be eaten by a bird. Fish infected by these parasites are forced to dance around the surface of the water and flash the colorful parts of their body. It would be like if someone came into your brain and made you run with scissors. If the parasite is successful, the dancing fish will eventually get picked off by a bird, infect the bird, and start the process all over again. There are probably hundreds of species of parasitic wasps. These wasps lay their eggs inside of a host and use the host as a source of food and protection for their offspring. On top of literally growing their babies in another animal, some of these wasps are able to turn their host into zombie slaves. This can happen in cockroaches, caterpillars, spiders, and corporate America. The Zatipota wasp is a parasitic wasp that lives in Costa Rica and preys on a very specific species of spider for its baby making. The wasp will begin by stabbing the spider and laying its eggs inside of it. The larva will then hatch and feed off the spider's hemolymph, aka blood, for sustenance. After a week, the satiated larva will take control of the spider's brain and force it to build a web for its cocoon. It has not said thank you once. After the slave spider has put in a tremendous amount of effort into making its cocoon web, the larva will burst out of the spider and consume it. It will then form a cocoon inside the protective web the spider has made for it and complain about how hard it were to get there. But really, it just stole everything from the weaker spider doing its best to succeed in the world. Kind of like corporate America.